Joining me now on the Knicks Film School podcast, I could spend the entire episode reading this individual's accolades, but I'm fairly certain you're going to want to hear him instead of me talk about him. So I will just start off by saying two things. NBA Hall of Famer and Fordham graduate. We have one of those two things in common. I'll let you guess which one. The voice of the Knicks, Mike Breen. Hi, Mike.
Hello, Jonathan. First off, congratulations on episode number 300. I did not come bearing gifts, but it's a pleasure to be on. I've told you this when I saw you. I love your passion for the Knicks. I love your knowledge of the game, and I've really enjoyed your work in covering the team that we both love.
And that love, thank you for saying that. That love is so evident when you do what you do. And to me, when I listen to you, it's not just love for the Knicks. You have a love of this sport that I think it's kind of like a love for a person that you have for a loved one. When did you first get that?
Well, I grew up in a family of six boys, and my father was a huge sports fan. So sports, it was not an option. It was a way, it was a way of life, and we played everything. And for some reason, it's hard to explain, but basketball just grabbed me. And it was always, for me, it was always the team aspect that I loved. I mean, obviously, individual talent was fantastic. And maybe I can blame this on the 1970 Knicks. There was nothing to me more beautiful in sports than when five guys worked together and they could beat anybody because they worked together, regardless of how much talent or size or ability the other team had. So I think that's when it really first started. But ever since I was a little boy, I loved all sports and I still do, but basketball is the one that's in my heart.
So your journey as an announcer, at least. Well, actually, I should ask, at Fordham, did you watch a ton of Fordham basketball? Because I will admit I did not when I was there.
Well, I went. One of the reasons I went to Fordham was because of the reputation of the college radio station, WFU. Sure. So that's why I went, and I went to almost every Fordham game, men's game that I could. And if it wasn't home, there was a whole bunch of us, and that included Michael Kay. Yeah. Of course, he's my best friend in college, and a number of other guys as well. Charlie Slows is a really good broadcaster. We would travel. We would drive to all the road games because we were hooked. And they were good. My years there, they were good. That was a Tom Pender's era where they were an NIT team every year. So I went to a lot of Fordham games.
So after that, obviously, you went to Marist. You first kind of got your wheels under you there. Those were the Smits years. I just want to make sure, right?
Yes. Well, Rick Smits was there, and it was the biggest game in town. It was wonderful. Dave McGarity, who just retired, who was a great, great college coach for over four decades. He was one of the coaches when I was there. It was really fun. It was a building called the McCann Center. I think it held about 3,200 people.
That's not bad.
Oh, it was nice. It was perfect for that program and that conference, and it was packed. Every Rick Smits game was packed. It was the place to be in Poughkeepsie, New York.
But during the 90s, I have to ask, was there ever any playful trash talk when you were calling the games and Smits was involved in those Pacers series?
No. He's too nice a guy and was great back then. By the way, when I did Marist games, Jonathan, I wasn't the play-by-play guy. I was the analyst. They had a long-time play-by-play guy. His name was Dean Darling. That's his real name. And I learned so much from him by sitting next to him and watching how he handled play-by-play on television. It was a great learning experience for me. He was a terrific announcer, and it served me well down the line.
So, well, you could say that again. Now we're talking, it's been, over 30 years. I want to start to tie together, your beginnings and this current team. I was watching the game last night, and we're recording this the day after they just had a tough loss in Miami. The refs, by the way, I know you are too kind to say anything. I will say it. That was not a kind job by them.
A couple of them. I was perplexed by a couple of them.
And the Randall one, you called out. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's one of the things I love about Tom Thibodeau, although he bit his tongue last night. He never uses that as an excuse.
No. So I'm watching there and they show Pat Riley, and I'm thinking about, obviously, we're going to do this interview. And I'm like, wow, you know, you got started calling the Knicks games on WFAN in 1992, and Pat was there, and Jeff was there. And within a few years, Tom would be there as well after Pat obviously left. And now here we are all these years later, and you got Pat down in Miami. You call games with Jeff for ABC. And we got Tom as the head coach of the Knicks. Have you, you know, stopped at any point this year and kind of looked around and been like, man, that's, this has been quite a journey over these last, you know, almost 30 years.
I'm not saying this to be corny, but I think that all the time. This is beyond my wildest dreams. I've been more blessed than I deserve. And to be, you know, the announcer for the team that I grew up loving as a kid all these years and meeting all these people. I mean, you mentioned those guys. I learned so much basketball from them. Especially Jeff, because when I first started, Jeff was the assistant coach, and you don't have that as much time with the head coach as you do with the assistants, you know, especially when you're young and breaking in, you want to kind of get as much knowledge. And Jeff was so good in teaching me the game and just listening to him. And then when he became the head coach, just listening to his press conferences and how he dealt with the highs and lows. And then a guy like Tom Thibodeau there, it was just a plethora of knowledge to soak up. And I couldn't get enough of it. But Riley was great. He was very intimidating for somebody like me when I first started. And I remember we had our first road game in Atlanta, and the hotel that the team stayed in, you'd have to turn the corner and then you'd walk toward the elevators. Now, I hadn't met Riley yet. This was the first road game, so I hadn't really met him yet. And I'm on the elevator ready to go upstairs. And all of a sudden he turns the corner and starts walking toward the elevator. And he says, hold the elevator. And I'm thinking, okay, this is my big chance. I'm going to finally get to meet him. I'm nervous about it. And I went to press the door open, but instead I hit the door close. And I mean, as right as he walks up to the elevator, it practically closed on his nose. And I'm riding up the elevator thinking, that's it. I'd be fired. But to show you the kind of person Pat Riley is, you know, I would do a pregame radio interview with him.
Yeah.
And you'd go back to him in his office, and his office was always dimly lit. So it was almost like you were seeing somebody that didn't want their face to be seen. Now, he was great. He gave great answers, but there was no small talk. You went in, you did the interview, and you left. So I didn't have a lot of interaction with him, even though I learned so much from him just by listening to him. So I wasn't even sure if he knew my name. And the season ended that year, and about a week after the season, I got a letter at my house, a handwritten letter from him, thanking me for the professional job that I did and being a part of what they accomplished. I was just blown away. And that's the kind of people that I've been around for all these years that teach you so much and you know, just make it all happen for you.
So you are clearly so appreciative, which is because of course you are, because you're Mike Breen. I want to actually flip that on its head. And I just, do you ever stop and realize to yourself that you are more beloved by this fan base of people than I will go ahead and say it, than any broadcaster broadcasting any games in this country or anywhere? Does that ever like permeate, or do you not allow yourself to think about that?
Well, first off, you've clearly lost your objectivity years by being a Knicks fan, because I mean, let's face it, every team has that announcer that's been around a long time that they love. And that's, I was the same way. I mean, Marv Albert to me has been and will always be the greatest basketball play-by-play voice of all time. So for me, he was the guy listening to, and you know, it just, you tend to feel like, at least what I hope for is you tend to feel like you want the fan base to think that you're one of them. And I've always felt that way because I was a Knicks fan. And I'm sure that fans get mad at me sometimes for whether I'm praising a player they don't like or I'm criticizing a player that they love. That happens. Can I tell you another story about how a fan helped me one time?
Please do.
I left the Garden one day, and this was during a couple of really dark years where they've been really brutal. And, you know, although I don't like to take out the hammer when I criticize, you have to criticize and you have to be objective. I think that's what Knicks fans really want.
It is.
I was fairly on a stretch of just being heavily critical because they were just playing so poorly. And I'm walking out of the garden and a young fan came up to me. I'd say he was probably about 30, very well dressed, was in a suit. And he comes up to me and he says, "Why do you hate the Knicks?" And I looked at him. I said, "Hate the Knicks? Are you kidding me? I've been in love with the Knicks since I was about 8 years old." He goes, "Well, all you do, you kill them on the air night after night." And I said to him, "What do you want me to do?" I said, "They're bad. They don't sometimes play with the effort. Defensively, they're not there." I said, I can't praise them. And he goes, "No," he goes, "I get it. I know we're a bad team." He goes, "But I watch almost every single night." He goes, "You don't have to hit me over the head with it on every possession." And you know what? It really gave me food for thought. And that, you know, the fan base that I'm broadcasting to on many nights, especially when the team's bad and only the diehards are watching night after night, that I have to think about them. And that as bad as they are, yes, I have to criticize, but at the same time, you know, talk about the one or two positives from that night, whether it's the rookie who got off the bench and scored 6 points in garbage time, or it's another player who hadn't hit a three-pointer in 3 weeks and he finally hit two in a row, you know, things like that. And it was a great lesson from a fan, from one of us, who told me, "Hey, I get it, but just think about the people that are out there watching." So as much as I hope the fans like what I do, I love the fans. I love the feedback from the fans. And that's the thing that I miss the most through this whole pandemic is not being able to see the fans and talk to them before the game. Every once in a while, I like to get there before the fans get in. I mean, I'm there always before the fans get in. Yeah. But I like to go up into the stands and sit in the seats somewhere up a little bit higher and watch the fans come in. And the excitement that I used to have when I was a fan and would go to the Garden to just remind me of what it means for a Knicks fan to come to the game in the Garden and see it. And it's a great reminder for me on what the team means to fans like you, fans like me, and for the fans that pay that kind of money and sit home and watch game after game after game. It's the most incredible fan base in sports. I know I'm not objective there. And I don't know if you heard that they're going to allow fans in at the end of the month. If I'm allowed to, I don't know, if I probably can't for social distancing, I might try and hug each of the 2,000 fans who are allowed in that first game, because I miss them way more than I ever thought.
Well, I was going to ask, what has it been like for you just to announce in a fairly empty building? That must be strange, right?
It is. It's. I don't like it, because, you know, I've always used my style, my call. I like to feed off the energy of the crowd, especially at the Garden. And the first couple of games, now down in the bubble was different. It was kind of like a Hollywood set that they had built. And it was beautiful. They did a great job. Obviously, the Knicks weren't there. But the first game we did at the Garden with no fans, it just didn't seem right. You know, once the game gets going, you have the energy because you're watching these great players play and you get fired up because it's the game that you love so much. But, you know, 2 minutes before the game, there's no fans. You're looking around like, where is everybody? And then when the game's over, a big shot's hit. It's just not as fun without them. And even 2,000 fans, I think, are going to make it so much better.
I think it will, too. You brought it up before, so I have to ask about this, because there, you know, I have League Pass like a lot of people listening, and I flip around. And there are a lot of announcers out there that are great announcers. But they're homers, and I don't think they try to hide the fact that they are homers. We just lost, obviously, maybe the greatest homer ever in Tommy Heinsohn not long ago, and he was fantastic. And that was part of his shtick, right? You have never once, to me at least, come off as a homer. But at the same time, and with all due respect to the fan that you mentioned in the story before, I don't think you've ever come off as overly harsh. I think you toe that line perfectly. And I was gonna, like, are you, as you are announcing games, are you cognizant of trying to kind of toe that line?
Well, I think, again, every market is different, Jonathan. Some markets, some fan bases, they want you to be rah-rah and everything pro-team, and that's what they want their announcers to do. That's what their bosses tell them to do. So, you know, I get it. And in some cities, that's what the fans want. But growing up watching the Knicks and being a Knicks fan, I never wanted that. I never got that from Marv. I mean, I took my lead from Marv on that. Marv was objective about the team that he was broadcasting for, and he got it from Marty Glickman. So that's the way I was brought up calling the games. But at the same time, I think most Knicks fans know I want the Knicks to win every night. I do, but I have to, from a professional standpoint, I've got to call it in an objective way to tell the truth of what's going on. And, you know, I like that the fact that you feel I don't really go after people, but I've always gone by the way I've thought about it is I won't say anything about a player on the air that I wouldn't say directly to his face. And I think that's the way. And I think sometimes, not a lot, but sometimes I think some of the media, whether it's writing, whether it's broadcasting, can be a little cruel. There's two ways to say everything. You can say a guy, boy, he is brutal tonight, awful, he shouldn't be allowed to play. Or you can say, wow, he's really struggling tonight. This has been a nightmare. This, you know, you say the same thing. One way, it's you're just taking shots at a guy to make yourself like, oh, I'm a tough broadcaster, I can go after people. You're doing it the same way where you make the point without being disrespectful. And I think sometimes some people get a little disrespectful in their criticism. Sometimes that's their job and they don't want to do it. And if that's their style, I'm fine with that. But that's not the way that I choose to do it.
And I am thankful. And I speak for many others when I say I'm thankful for that. A couple more. You've been so generous with your time. This year, you have not had to be as critical as in some years past. This has been a fun one. I know they're only, as we're recording this right now, they're 11 and 15. It has, from afar, felt different than some other years in the past. And the only thing that I can really reference in terms of the effort that they're coming out and playing with every night is those Van Gundy years, is those Riley years. Do you get the same sense that this team has a little bit of that in them?
Oh, more than a little. They've got it. And it's, you know, I mean, Jeff was a disciple of Riley and Tom's a disciple of Jeff and they're all together. And it was not a surprise. I was, you know, there were a number of candidates that may have been terrific, but I thought at this particular time, Tom Thibodeau was the perfect coach for a franchise that needed to show, okay, we're a professional basketball team that's going to compete every night. He has never, ever been a guy that makes excuses. Even when he was in Chicago, Minnesota, if he had three starters out, he still went into that locker room before the game and told his team that they have a chance to win tonight. They can win with what they have. He's always believed that. And that's a belief that he passes along to his team. And the other thing, and this goes back to what Jeff was like, it goes back to Pat Riley, the importance of practice and the importance of repetition and the drills. And they are as prepared every single night. And that's the thing that's been amazing is they have a chance to win every night as long as they play together and they play for each other. And he does that by pounding it into them day after day after day. I can't remember. It may have been either Randall or Peyton who said after like the first 2 weeks of camp, if we're not running the play exactly the way he wants, he'll Peyton. Do it 100 times.
It was Peyton.
And
yeah.
That's what makes it happen. That's what makes it work. And, you know, he said the first thing he said to him is, if we practice well, we're going to play well. And you can just see it. You can see in the confidence in the players. You can see confidence in the game plan. And I just love to see a team that's so well coached. And the one thing I knew coming in that I didn't know what this team, this roster's potential was, but I knew whatever that potential was, they were going to reach that potential because he would demand it. And that's, you still need that. Now, some teams he might not be perfect for, but this team, I think he was because the veterans, the Randalls, who have never been to the playoffs, they want somebody to show them how to get to the playoffs. And they're at that point now. The younger players, you know, most younger players are just sponges. They want to absorb so much. So I think it was the perfect fit right now.
Well, it's been enjoyable to watch. It's been great to watch you and to listen to you. This next year is going to mark 30 years that you have been calling Knick games. I was looking up some of the other greats of your profession, and I couldn't help but think of maybe the greatest, Vin Scully, another Fordham guy, did it for 67 years with the Dodgers. I have to ask, have you thought about, like, you could keep going for a really long time and just, I don't ever want you to leave. And this is basically my plea to ask you, please never leave and always continue calling Knick games. Have you thought about how much longer you want to keep doing this for?
No, I'm not to that point yet. But I've said a number of times. I'll call Knick games for as long as they'll have me, because it really is a true joy for me. It's like another family. It's, you know, not just the people in the organization, but it's the fans, it's the workers of the garden. And, you know, one thing for me that makes it so much fun is I work with a crew at the garden that is just off the charts. Most of us have been there, or at least the core have been there. A lot of Knick fans don't know who they should know who Howie Singer is. He's the director, Spencer Julian. He's the producer. Those two guys are just as important of bringing Knicks basketball to the fans as any announcer. And I've been with those two guys, for Howie with the entire time, for Spencer about 20 years. And then, of course, there's Clyde, who I just, you know, to go from having a guy who was my idol growing up to be a lifelong friend. I mean, you don't make this stuff up. And everybody on the crew loves him, absolutely loves him. And, you know, it's just a great group that we have together. Of course, Rebecca Harlow, the sideline. It's just, you know, we're like a family, and it's fun to be around your family.
You stole my last question. I was going to ask, is Clyde the coolest person that you've ever met, or is he just the coolest person in the history of people? But that's probably an unfair question.
He's probably both. The interesting thing was, when we first met, I was so nervous. But people don't understand this. And again, this is 30 years ago. Clyde was a little on the introverted side. You know, on the air, he's flamboyant, but he's, you know, he's guarded as any player who achieves that kind of status can be. But he has, you know, he's, once you get to know him, he's just the most warm, friendliest person who loves being around people. I think he's embraced his role of who he is as a New York City sports star and a sports legend, as well as any pro athlete who's ever done it. When I have friends come down to meet me after the game, and they, you know, they're so afraid to meet Clyde, he greets them with such warmth. It's just, it's a blessing for all of us, for me to work with him, for our crew to work with him, and for the fans to get to have him, because he's just one of a kind.
Well, we love Clyde. We love this team. But I feel comfortable speaking on behalf of Knick fans. We love you and we thank you. And I will say this in front of everybody on a personal note. When we met up, what was it? Gosh, time's been flying, about a year and a half ago now. And I came and said hi to you in the garden. When you knew who I was the moment that I'm like, okay, maybe I'm not wasting my time doing all this silly blogging and podcasting and whatnot. So thank you for that. And thank you for coming on here. People have their like three dinner guests. I have like my three ideal podcast guests. I can now cross one off the list. So thank you for coming on, really.
Well, it's my pleasure. Like I said, we're brothers in Knick fandom. Although it might not always seem it on the air, I'm a huge Knick fan, just like yourself, like all the fans are. And I love your passion and how hard you work at it and how much it means to you. And it's been enjoyable reading you and watching you. So keep it up. Let's go for another 300.